A Beautiful Thing Inside a Secret World of Bombay's Dance Bars is a work of narrative nonfiction, which, as William says, took me about 5 years to research and write. It's the story of a bar dancer, a 19-year-old girl who I met when I was in my late 20s, and with whom I developed a friendship of sorts, and who fascinated me so much that I asked her if I could tame her, if I could be a part of her life, not just in terms of her work life, but play as well. So in the few months, or almost a year in which we spent together, I went everywhere from the dance bars that she, the dance bar where she worked in, to the brothels where her friends were. I hung out with her lover, Pusho Prashetti, who was the owner of the dance bar. We went to a spiritual site called Haji Malang. And I wanted to write about Leela for one primary reason initially, which is that to me, she represented this incredible subculture, which was at the Bombay dance bars. And these dance bars at the time, which was in 2005, were about 1,500 in number, and they employed about 75,000 women. And for some of you who may not be familiar with the culture of the dance bar, it's essentially a place where men go to be entertained, to have a drink, and to throw money at women who dance at a distance on an elevated platform, and are not allowed to in any way interact with the men who've come to see them. So they let alone touch them, you can't even talk to them. So to me, you know, the dance bars sort of epitomized the best and the worst of Bombay. They were the best in the sense that somebody who might have otherwise had to live with the violence and degradation of a certain kind, or being born into a certain kind of caste, would not have to continue in that profession, say if it was a certain kind of entertainment profession that involves sex work, but she could instead go to the dance bar where her primary income came from dancing and not sex work. So it was great in that sense. It gave so many women a taste of what it was to be independent, to be free, and most of all, to support themselves and their family. And of course, it was in the worst in the sense that although the women were the focus of the dance bar, it was their beauty and glamour that attracted people. At the end of the day, those who controlled them were men. So it was the dance bar owners, the gangsters who jested in the bars, it was the politicians who manipulated the cops, it was the cops who harassed and took cover from them. So it was a very fascinating world for me to enter, and one that I wanted to talk about. But in 2005, a few months after I met Leela, the state government of Maharashtra decided that dance bars encouraged immorality and they corrupted the youth, and therefore they should be shut down. Now, we don't even have to go into that discussion because, after all, this is a ridiculous discussion to imagine that a politician can tell us what is immoral or moral, and that there is apparently no immorality in throwing girls as young as 16, numbering 70 to 75,000 out into the street, and then pretending not to know what work, line of work they would get into. To which, of course, the answer is they will get into whatever work they know. And if a girl is born into a particular kind of caste, which is in any way attached or influenced by sex work, you know that is the work that she will be forced into if you take away her genuine legal livelihood. And so when the ban happened, and when I, at this time, still knew Leela very well, it was so devastating, it was so immediate, so complete, that I felt it had to be written about. And I wanted to write about it in a way that was accessible. And for me as a reporter, the most accessible way, and I think William will agree with this, is to tell a story. You know, we in India, we're used to throwing around numbers, and after a while, these numbers have no meaning for us. And we also talk a lot about politicians when we know that what they're saying isn't entirely true and is motivated by personal and political concerns. So this is essentially a story, a personal, intimate story about a young girl, 19-year-old, beautiful, feisty, very courageous, and about the people around her. One of the people around her that I'm going to read to you about is her mother, Apsara. Apsara, I wouldn't use the word colluded, but she stood by when Leela was sold by her father and picked up when she was as young as 12 and 13 to the neighborhood cops. Apsara didn't have the courage to stand up for Leela. At the same time, she had sympathy for her daughter. And so you can imagine that this was a very awkward, very disturbing relationship from which Leela never recovered. In the excerpt that I'm now going to read for you, Apsara, completely unannounced, lands up in Leela's apartment after a very long period. She's coming from Meerut and she comes with these two heavy suitcases, much to Leela's disgust. Now Apsara, caring little that we had only just met, and if anyone's presence in her daughter's flat needed explanation, it was mine, launched into her personal history. She put aside her knitting, which she clearly hadn't given up on, despite the difficulties the task presented, and to ensure my full attention, hijacked my wrist. She moved this way and that, edging so close I could smell her gutkha breath. I appreciated its minty freshness, for it seemed she also enjoyed deep-fried snacks. "Every time my mister gets drunk," Apsara said, breathing heavily, "he behaves like a buffalo rummaging through a sugarcane field. With God's grace, if I manage to run away, all he can do is throw something in my direction. A chair, a stool, the knife he insists on keeping in his back pocket like he's a hunter baller. But if he catches me, here I am. God says by fire, and the devil says, Apsaraji, kill her child. One limb at least was crack." Leela rolled her eyes. "Apsaraji's fat, and she's very, very simple." By simple, Leela meant stupid, but in a kindly way. "My mother is simple," she would shrug when I asked why her mother hadn't taken her away from Manohar. "My mother is simple," she would comfort herself when she heard from her brothers that Apsara had spent her money hours on custom-fitted motorcycles and satellite radios for them. Leela's brothers were unemployed and, hoping to remain so, reminded her in STD calls she paid for that they were praying for her health. "Buy yourself a box of Shimla apples," they would instruct, as though it was on them. "Eat almond soaked overnight for breakfast. Drink a quarter liter of cow's milk every morning." Leela saw through this. "What will happen to them if I fall ill and cannot dance?" She stuck her palm out. "Madam, paisa dona, dona paisa, madam." They agree. All of this, Leela wanted me to know Apsara's attitude towards her son's stupidity and sloth, who knew, perhaps even Manohar's antagonism, was a product of Apsara's weight and girth and the fact that she was unforgivably simple. Leela looked at her mother thoughtfully. "Since I could see, I saw my father beating my mother. I didn't know ABC, but I knew what it meant when Manohar threw aside his plate. That's why I ran away. Because he abused her. Once he hit her so hard, she fainted. And because she didn't say no, he abused me, and I knew that if I stayed on, if I didn't say no, one day he would do the same to my children. Now I see her sons have inherited this quality from their father. They think women were created by God to serve men like them. And that's what makes me so angry. That she can see what they can think of her. She sees it because I can see it, and neither of us is blind. And yet she supports them. She loves them. She loves them more than she loves me. But why? Why, when I am the successful one, the one who works, who feeds her, who clothes her, who asks if she has taken her medicine? Why, when I am the one who had the courage to leave for the city, when I am the one who became a success and made money, makes money, money like a man? No, more than a man. I'll tell you why. Because they're boys. And I'm a girl, nothing but a girl. The value of a boy is twice that of a girl, isn't it, Somami? Even if the boy is useless. Apsara's eyes welled. That's not true. Yes, it is. It's not true, Leela. Okay. I'm not strong like you, Apsara said. You're not strong, that is true. But remember, Mummy, your sons are wives now. You keep pampering them with my money and so they like you. Will they hold you as close? What will happen, Mummy, when I decide that like them, I don't want to work? I want to be taken care of. One day, I will want to be loved. What will happen to you then? Your brothers are good boys, Leela. Don't empty your thali, Mummy, that's all I'm saying. You're giving Sonia the wrong impression about us, cried Apsara, throwing her knitting needles in distress. What will she think? Sonia